I think we're ready to go. Okay, all right. Well, I guess it's not broken. Man, that was really weird. Sorry about that. Welcome to day 253, Making Songbringer. Today I'm making a data-driven dungeons, data-driven world, data-driven overworld, everything. You guys probably seen this mock-up I'm working on. So basically I'm working towards getting that in the game, but making it so it's super easy to add new dungeons with all new artwork. Every time I want to create it, there's gonna be like nine dungeons or more. So it's gonna be so worth it to have everything as data. Here's kind of what I'm thinking so far. This is just a note up here, but basically like the overworld. The ground for the overworld will have a terrain and then a procedurally generated texture. And then on certain flags, there's other things like rocks added and waterfalls and stuff. No, it didn't. It didn't. I just upgraded Game Show, and Game Show was really glitching out there for a second. But yeah, it seems to be okay now. So we're all right. We're all right, man. How are you doing, dude? How's it going, man? How's it going with your body, man? Recovering everything. Yeah, so the next thing I'm gonna start doing is getting this to work here. This creating the overworld textures and everything from data. This is totally data. It's gonna be in the game. It's gonna replace a lot of code. Man, I feel good doing this. Oh yeah. Let's throw these up here. What's up, JFK? High five, man. Arcane, what's up, yo? Going really good, man. What's my plan for today? So I'm still working on I'm working on getting this new dungeon art in, right? Or this is the goal, right? To be able to have a new, totally new style dungeon, totally different art. And my goal right now is to take that art. There's lots of different pieces of art here. You know, there's like this rib bone here. There's this standing statuey thing here. There's this little piece of pumpkiny peyote or something here, and then there's this grass and this dais thing or whatever that is, and then the ground itself. So I'm trying to make that all data-driven, completely data-driven world. And I've got this sort of outline, this mock-up text file here. This is good. This is the new kind of format for how I might represent the entire world with data rather than code. So this is going to be sweet. Once I finally have this done, I can go and create new worlds, new dungeons, new levels of the world really quickly. So this might be a task. This might take me all week to kind of get this going, but who knows? It'll be so worth it. It'll make dungeons super quick to implement. What's up, Lime? Is it a shockwave in the middle? No. There's just there's a dais thing in the middle. It's a ground texture. So if I turn off the heroes, you can see, and I turn off the bones. So you can see that this is basically just a little platformy piece of stone or whatever. Is that what you're asking? Yeah, right on. Yeah. It's so great. It's so great to make things data driven. There's two big things that have really sped up, like made my game development more rapid, and that is using an entity component system and making everything data driven. Once you've got those two things going, you can code so much less. All you got to do is write some more data and you're good to go. And maybe hook up a few methods that play off new types of data or whatever. Okay. All right. Yeah. There's no shock. Maybe there should be a shockwave though. Maybe that would be cool. Awesome. Yeah, data-driven basically just means that, I'm taking data and creating a world. So let me show you exactly what that means here with creating. I got ground tile, general shading. Here we go. Right now I have this function, right? This is code which goes and creates some terrain that's going to be used in creating a procedurally generated texture for the ground. That's what this function does. It creates the ground for the overworld, and all that cool like texturing you see in the overworld going on, that all happens here in this method. But now I'm trying to make that method, and instead of making a code, I want to make it mostly data driven so that I can do this. So instead of the terrain size being locked in the code or whatever, this is hard coded. You know what I mean? I can go and make it all there in one little bit of data there. I've defined that I want the ground texture to have a terrain being generated, and here's the size of it, and here's how many thresholds I want for the how many thresholds of terrain levels there are. You know what I mean? So that's one way I can take that, just these two lines. I know it seems like only two lines, but really there's a lot more going on behind these two lines. But anyways, the point is, instead of that being hard-coded, just code, that's now going to be flexible, data-driven stuff. So I can go and change it. Like I say, I want to have nine thresholds, whatever, I change that. But that's not the big picture. The big picture is having the entire world data-driven. Because that's going to allow me, for example, I'm now creating this new psychedelic dungeon thing here. It would be so sweet if I already had this data-driven system so that I could quickly implement everything for the world. Like, okay, I want the ground to be an image of sand. I want to have it to have this overlay going on. And here's some entities I would want to put in the world, right? So I hope that makes sense as far as what data-driven means. Oh, the bones and the sand. Oh, okay. I see ya. All right. So the first thing I'm gonna do is I'm gonna start taking this data for creating the ground for the overworld and make it into a data-driven method instead of being a regular old-school method. So I'm gonna put the player back at the home screen. And you get the point pretty quickly. So, like all this ground here, the texturing going on. Turn that off so your sound quality is good. Yeah, so even this little bump right here, and this little indentation right here, and all the little texturing you see going on, the randomness, all of that is going to be data driven from this one method here. Nice, cool. Okay, so area, let's do this. We need to grab the data. For now, I'm just grabbing it based on a word. But I'm not exactly sure how this overall structure will go, so I'm just doing it kind of loosey-goosey at this point. I might change all this, but overworld. So there, I'm grabbing the overworld key. Now I'm gonna grab the ground key, and we're gonna create the terrain and the texture based on that. So I'm grabbing the child of overworld ground. All right, so simple. Once okay, so now let's we're gonna create the terrain. No, I'm writing that right now. Yeah, I'm writing it as we speak. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, it's not that there's no code or anything. There's code, of course, but it's just that the code is flexible enough to respond to different data. It's data driven. So, this terrain here. Let's create that. We've got a size and thresholds. That's under the terrain. So grabbing the terrain child. Oh, that's, never mind. All data. All data. So now I'm grabbing the size from the terrain. Yeah, that's a stir. All right, so we're gonna parse this. I got that, and I'm gonna grab it and turn it into those two numbers there. So we'll parse out the vector. Yep, that one works. Parse vector string delim. So the string we have is stir and the delim is an X. I might need to check for an X in here. I guess we could just multiply. That's fine. Size that width. Size that X. Times equals area. Size that width. And here's where we'll check if it's decent values. So if size.x is greater than, this is in pixels, right? So this is gonna need to be, I don't know, greater than 100. And less than, let's see, 128. There. So that's how big this texture can be, right? That's a good flexible range. Anything outside that range would be crazy, right? To try and create and locate that kind of terrain size. So do terrain generate, this is Perlin noise terrain, which is generated based on Perlin noise, of course. This gives you the number of areas. This is the actual area width and area height. And then when you call get height, what's that? Return height. Oh, right. Okay. The height is the number of areas times the area height. Okay. Good. So if the height is different, yeah. Okay. So we've got all these specified. And if the terrain.getHeight is not equal to size dot y. Here we go. This is where we do it all. Size dot x. And we also need to parse the thresholds from this. So I know this looks like, right, I've added lines of code, but, right, so it seems like more to maintain, but no, it's actually a lot better not having to do that. What's up, Azarus? Mighty Nest, Wista So, yo, you guys? Welcome, welcome, welcome. Once again, I'm working on this. I'm making this new dungeon art easy to add to the game by making it data driven. So I've kind of gone through the existing ground. The ground is different in like every world, right? The overworld has its own procedurally generated ground. The stone type of dungeons have their own type of ground. This new psychedelic dungeon has its own type of ground. So I'm going through and making this all data driven. I'm starting with the overworld. So I'm starting with this here. I'm creating some, this is where it, this is a way of representing the overworld's ground with data. So that's it. I'm at this part right here. Terrain, size, number of thresholds. And then this is where it's going to be procedurally creating a texture. All right, and we're also going to need the float number of thresholds. Thanks, man. Yeah, tons more variety. Yeah, once this is in there, and it'll be way cool too, because look at this. This is something I'm really excited in here. The psychedelic dungeon, right, has all these new types of art, you know, like this, like for example, this big pillar thing here. Whatever this is, this wouldn't it be so sweet if I could represent that with data rather than having to write more code for every dungeon. It'd be so sweet if I could just say, okay, I have this type of dungeon and I want to put some plants, and those plants should be about 1x1x2, and they should have this whatever kind of collision category of static or whatever. You know what I mean? It's going to be so great to be able to represent an entire dungeon, a totally new dungeon type entirely with data. So it'll be so quick to make new levels. What's up, Alex Pita? High five, man. Hope you're doing good. Okay, so back here to thresholds. This is going to be d.getChild. Thresholds. Dot get float, or int maybe, actually ints. Yeah, int, I think is the thing to do here. Int thresholds. And then thresholds. There, all right, we've abstracted that. We've made this data driven, let's test it. Right, this is creating dirt one, ground, overworld, ground, terrain, size, thresholds, everything data driven. Yeah, exactly. An entire dungeon in about 20 lines of data. Yes, it'll be a lot of refactoring code. That's why I'm saying it might take me an entire week just to get all this done, making this all data driven. But once it's done, yeah, a whole new dungeon will be 20 more lines of text. So easy to add, and a mock-up art, which could take me like, instead of a whole dungeon taking me 2 weeks to create, a whole dungeon could take me like 2 days. Probably exaggerating there, but you get the point. Nice, man. Good. Right on. Hello, comments. What's up, Marza? How you doing? Marza, you just joined, man. I'm working on making all the dungeons data-driven, so I'll be able to load an entire dungeon definition from data rather than how it is now where it's all code. So let's see if that worked, creating this terrain. Nice. Okay, so we loaded it, we parsed it. What do we get? There's the string. The size it parsed was 679, which is should be 420 times 1.618. Yeah, cool. We got the right width and height here. Nice. And thresholds as well is an important. All right, that's six. Cool. This should work. Not greenlit yet? What? What? Did you see? You saw an improvement, right? You did see an improvement. Are you still getting? Are you getting steady? Oh wait. Of course. Sorry. We just talked about this yesterday. Just you're like right at the top of the charts. And you're not getting greenlit. You know what's so cool about your situation is that you're probably getting a lot of impressions at this point, and you're generating a lot of awareness for your projects. So that's pretty rad. That's kind of one of the downsides of going through green light really fast is that you get overall a lot less people becoming aware of your game. And that could be a huge difference down the road. When you go to actually put your game on Steam, you release it and whatever. All those people that voted yes on your green light, they get notified and everything. So green light is huge. Green light is a really great thing, it seems kind of like it sucks that you're waiting there, but it's really awesome. So yes, it is. It's 420 right now. Oh, I wish I could. Oh, it's only four here. Yeah. Well, that means you're probably up against the other top games on Greenlight right now, so that's probably why you're at a plateau or something. Are you still getting impressions though, and new yes votes and things like that? But especially impressions. PMC, what's up, man? Can you use gameplay footage of my game for a video you're making? Why don't you email me about this? We'll talk more about it. My email is nat@wizardfoo.com. Just type that for you, natitwizardfoo.com. All right. Oh, in terms of votes and impressions. Yeah, so Asmerus is asking you about what game, I think. Right, man, see ya. Okay. And yes, that worked. And then terrain to get at, yes. Sweet. Let's see what we got here. This came in with areas X1, width 679, height 288, threshold 6. Boom. Nice. Okay, we just verified that. That's working. Okay, so the next thing. That's great. We got one bit of this now data driven, right? That seems like a tiny amount, but it's actually pretty awesome. Every little step of this is freaking awesome. So, okay, next thing is the texture. Yeah. All right, texture it is. All right, so here in the texture, next thing we're gonna get, the rest of this entire method is all dedicated to drawing a texture, except until it gets to the very end here. And what's all this commented out code? We don't need any of this. We do not need that. Let's get rid of that. So all we got now is this entity, which is represents the texture, and these other methods, which are going to be, we'll make those flexible here in a sec. Yeah, it's refactoring time. Yep. How do you get to green light? Oh yeah, right. How do you get to that, right? Yeah, I know it's right. It's kind of buried on Steam Community's website. Yeah, Lime Studios. What if you're like one vote away? You might be like, right? That'd be so funny. As like if Azimuth goes and votes and boom, all of a sudden you're greenlit. Who said voting doesn't? Who said your vote doesn't count? Your vote does count. Oh yeah, man. I don't know if this works here if I just type it right into the chat. I've never tried this. Oh, it does. There you go. Yeah, Wizardfoo. That's me. It's all over my websites. Yeah. I hope it does, dude. I hope it does. Yeah, actually that happened to me. Songbringer got greenlit during the stream one day, and people let me know. They're like, "Hey, dude, did you know it's greenlit?" I'm like, "What? Sweet." Because like when you go to the link or whatever, it says to other people, "Hey, this game's been greenlit." So people told me before I even knew. That's why I didn't really remember if Steam announced it to me, emailed or notified. Okay, so this kind of sucks, but all of this code right here needs to go inside. No, this doesn't suck that bad. I'm gonna put all this inside its own block because it belongs inside its own function. So, it does kind of suck to indent all this all like this, but I'm actually gonna move this into its own function at some point. Okay, so the first thing I want to make data driven here is texture outdoors. Is that really necessary? This word outdoors? Not really. Let's take that out. So, okay, we've got colors. The colors we're going to use for making this texture, whether or not it has edges, whether or not it has splotches, how much noise to add, and how many shadows to add. Shadows, yeah. That'll all work. Okay. Wait a second. Terrain might be also a part. I think this is a part of that. Terrain. Splotch terrain. General shading gives that is based on the terrain. Okay, yeah, this might actually be better to represent in one. Right, so this might actually be better represented right there. Texture, terrain. Yeah, because these two things are totally linked. Right, so we'll call this texture data. Ground texture terrain. Right, actually, so this texture data. Yeah, we don't even need this ground anymore. Data get child ground. Dot get child Child texture. So I've got texture data now. All right. So if texture data isn't null, this is where we're going to process all this stuff. Now, the terrain is going to be a child of texture data. Get child terrain. All right, let's verify that one more time. Now that it's been changed a little bit. We should have size. Yep. Thresholds, great. Okay, cool. Dang, dude. I have days like this all the time, man. All the time. All right, next we're on to texture size. Yeah, might as well do texture size. Azurus confirmed a robot. So same, I'm gonna do the same kind of thing here. So this thing is the size 1.0, 1.0 for now. This is gonna be, yeah. Oh wow, actually, okay, I just thought of this terrain. This terrain is actually, we only use this terrain once. Not here, spot, this is splotch terrain. We only use it here for terrain shading. Might refactor that too. Wait. All right, next we'll get the size. Valtry is still missing inline arrays definition support. What you mean by inline arrays? Oh. Yeah, I mean, this is a layer you can add on top of Valtry, or you can subclass Valtry and add something like specific like that. Arrays of data, right, I get you. That might be helpful actually to add that somehow. Yeah, man. See you, Lime. Good night, man. Yeah, totally. Me too. So I'm going to grab the texture data size. Let's actually pull this out and make it a variable we're going to use over and over here, vec2v. So then we can parse the vector a little easier. I think I've got this already in a parse. Yeah, we can pass in a const string and then it fills up the vec rather than having to return it by value, which is slower. So we'll go parse vector, str v. Yeah, Marza has. Marza has definitely already submitted code to Valtry. Right. Arrays of max. That's definitely where it gets complicated. Definitely agree. So, yeah. All right, man. Gosh, I don't know how you think so well so late at night anyways. I definitely, by midnight, I definitely lose all my energy usually. But, you know, that all depends on your schedule or whatever. But, okay, size. Let's parse that vector again. All right, so size x is going to be area size dot width times v dot x, v dot y, and it'd be probably expedient to make these unsigned. Does that work? Changing that to unsigned? Why not? Why the hell not make these unsigned? In fact, I wonder why those are signed. Nice, Pedro. I think he already left, but I hope that he got greenlit just from your vote. That'd be so great. Cause he's so close. He's like literally on the edge. He's going to be greenlit any second now. The report a bug page from what? Was that? Is that on Steam or something? So now we got to confirm this size before we go create the terrain. Once again, this should be a, yeah, this should be a, its own method. Yeah, this needs to be its own method, like right now. I'm switching this, refactoring this. To report a bug for that. Oh, it's for his game. Report a bug for that. Okay, so we're gonna create terrain based on some Valtry data. It's gonna create a terrain. Where should I put this method? Yeah, this will work here. Create terrain. Or create ground texture. That's what this is. Create ground texture. Takes a Valtry. Metabugs. Can these be implemented in Songbringer? Why not? What exactly is a metabug? That's a bug of a bug. Bugged bugs as foes. So okay, I'm imagining they're actually insect enemies and they're wearing a wire. Is that what a bug is? All right, now all of this is gonna go into its own method so it can easily return. Awesome. Awesome. Yes. Awesome. Create ground tile. No, create ground texture. Boop. Yeah. There you go. Right on. You guys, dude, good planning. All right, now all this doesn't need to happen here. Create dirt one ground. We can just go this create ground texture based on texture data. Which is essentially just world data. Like get child ground, get child texture. There. Whoo, nice, man. Love it. Love it, love it, love it. All right, so yeah, this makes it so much simpler, right? If texture data is null, return, or if data is null, data is null, return. Bam. Easy. Don't need this indent anymore. Likewise, we can do a simple thing here with the terrain being generated too. Oh, that's an interesting one. Attacks you, but it heals you. Right, here we go. So this thing, if size X is less than 128. Or size Y less than 128. Let's make this 100, actually, 90, 64, whatever. These could be a little smaller. So size X, or size X is like greater than something huge, like 4096. It's just way too big for a pixel art texture. Actually, I'd better to keep that as 2048. Return! There! We got values that are guaranteed to be within range. Nice. Randomly attacks another bug. I like that. Randomly tries to suicide but fails and heals you. Randomly submits a bug report. There you go. Now we've got the true definition of a meta bug, right? A bug that creates a bug and submits a bug report, right? It's like a nice meta bug. Maybe there's evil meta bugs too. Evil meta bugs don't submit any bug reports. All right, now let's run this out to that point. And get rid of this BS we don't need anymore. See. If you submit a bug, your account will be deleted, your PC's burned. Your house is burned, your car is burned, and your bank account is burned too. I know, there's too many magic numbers. But these, I don't know where to, I guess I can put these as. Yeah. Okay, you know what? Good point, Marza. Good point, Marza. I should at least have these as consts right here. Const int, okay, min text size. Okay, max text size. There we go. Yay, less magic numbers. Happy. I'm happy. I'm definitely happier by that. Same thing up here. I should do that. All right, what did we parse? What did we get? What did we get? Yes, Azarus, as always, help me see the bright side of it all. Thanks, man. Size X, 420. Size Y, 240. Good. That's what we wanted. The stir was 1-1. The V should have come out as 1-1. Yeah. All right. To fill the C4. Yeah, you are. You're a time traveler, man. You're already in the future. You know things we don't. It's amazing. Right, so the min terrain size is going to be 128. Max terrain, 4096. Is that too big? Yeah, that's kind of big. Let's keep that as 2048. Yeah. Okay, cool. Now we can plug in these numbers, and it's gonna be way less magic, but less magic in a bad way. More magic in a good way. Min terrain size. Max terrain size. Thanks. Thanks for helping me keep my code nice and clean. This is great. All right, good. Yay. That's one more little bit of this data driven. Tomorrow was a great day. I love this sentence, man. I wish we got a. Oh, this is great, dude. I wish I had that hanging on my wall. Tomorrow was a great day, comma. Believe me. Oh, you can't even see the ending. There you go. Perfect. Yes, this is guaranteed. This is great business. Great business right here. Okay, what's the next thing? We got size. We need colors. Let's parse out these colors. Tomorrow was a great day, believe me. All right, it's an official idea. Okay. Now we're gonna get the stir equals data get child. What's up, Beetle? Hidden collectible posters. Ooh, like the cards on Steam. Right, so this child, What are we looking for? Oh, colors. And we... Yeah, so it's, we got color and we got color too. Now we're gonna parse these. Will this be on Steam? This game, yes, it's on Steam already, man. But not, it's not for sale yet. It's coming soon on Steam. There's a good chance it's also going to come to consoles. It's not official yet, but it might come to PlayStation 4, Xbox, that kind of stuff. But my primary focus is on the Steam release, the Windows, Mac, Linux. Really, really excited about that. Parse colors. All right. We've got the string. We're going to parse it out into two. Okay. So vector, we need a vector of strings. Words, we'll split that, split str based on comma into words for each word. And now let's go, if words dot size is greater than zero, then we'll then C equals RGB words. Oh, this isn't RGB, this is grass or dirt. We need to parse this actual word. That's right. It's gonna be about $15, something like that, maybe less. Yeah, I was tempted to make it 20 for a while, but I've seen a lot of other games in my league, you know, approximately that kind of indie game, and $20 is a little bit too much, I think. Yeah, I'm gonna pay you guys $20 to play it. Don't even have to review it. Don't even have to like it. Hell, take my money. Take my money, play my game. Take my money, play my game. Yeah, sorry, man. It's not a free-to-play game. Yeah, you got months, man. You got tons of months. You need to save like 50 cents a month. That's it. Ah. Alright, so we're getting. We need to grab which kind of word this is. So, okay. We've got words, K colors, color types. Dot find. String. This might have to be verified here. This is the first word. So word zero. Right? Is that all we do? Is that how color types work? No, it's not. Color types. The color types constants. What are those? Color type. Oh, of course. They're going to be a string to int, which is the actual K color thingy. Yeah. Dang, man, that sucks. The game was so hyped, you know? What about that other game by the Fallout guys? What's up, Blood? How you doing, man? Things are going great here. What's the new game that was just on Kickstarter? What's it called? It's not Bethesda. It's not from Bethesda, but it is from the original guy that created the first Fallout. Oh, what the hell? It's not on here. Wasteland. Oh, of course. You guys are probably like, Wasteland. Yeah, yeah. It's right here in the chat. Yeah, Wasteland 2. Have you guys played that yet? Especially you, Mighty Nest. If you're unhappy with Fallout, how have you played Wasteland? You guys are all like Wasteland 2. Yeah, Wasteland. Is that any good? Has anybody played that? K color. Yeah, this should come out like that. Okay. So we're gonna get the color type. So we'll go auto color type. Auto color type equals. Yeah. So I wait. Paul, I think you told us already why you were unhappy with Fallout, but tell us again. What is it about Fallout 4 they could have done better maybe to make it a good game or in your opinion? This is really interesting stuff, you know. How can we where are the Where are the places where we can improve as game developers, you know? Oh, okay. So it's not really as like authentic or Fallout 1-y. I get you. Back. What's up? Yeah, we were doing so many things. So much. We were talking about the best stuff while you're gone. We were like, Mars is gone. Let's talk about cool stuff now. Okay, does the color types, do they come in zero? Color type. Yeah, we can. We can get a color type zero. Oh, this is a find. Actually, that can return end, I think, right? Oh, the control scheme, huh? Ah. Yeah. Yeah. Oh, dang. Oh, okay, so it's kind of technical things, huh? All right. You've already tagged this video as spam? Yeah, it's huge, right? They have a huge budget for that game. Yeah. Huh. Yeah, I get you, right? It's a post-apocalyptic game. Why is it so bright? I hear you on that. Dang. So K color types is a map type, which is a map string int. Oh, and actually, this is an iterator, so. It is not equal to words. Okay, color types dot end. I think I know I have a method for this already, but let's do this would be C equals colors. It. No, maybe it's second. Actually, yeah, int sec colors it second. We should probably do if There. Now it's safe. Invisible ink, huh? Maybe just for once, Ifago is a fun and cool event. Yeah. Wow. Huh. Wow. Interesting. Yeah, the last one I played was four or three, maybe. Might have been three. Snake Eater, whatever that one that was. Oh, wow. Crazy. What's up, Rocket Bunny? Good, man. I'm still working on, some new stuff today. I'm still, the goal is still to get this in the game, right? I got this new mock-up art, but I got a higher, loftier goal, and that is to make it data-driven so that it's really quick and easy for me to add new dungeons. Like, imagine if I could have 20 lines of text that defined an entire dungeon. It would be very quick to be able to create new dungeons. So that's what I'm creating now. I'm gone through today. I've already added a few different words, and now I'm working on this line right here. So data driven world, data driven dungeons, everything data driven. Tomorrow was a really good day. Else, I guess we could do C equals RGB from string str or words 0. Okay, now this definitely needs to be its own method here. So I'll make a parse color method. Damn. Rocket Bunny, this is a great question here. What do you do when you get stuck on how to program something? This is a big question, right? Especially when you're first getting started. Okay, so I'm gonna give you my advice here, all right? Listen up. The thing is, what you want to do is start learning how to use your subconscious mind. You have a conscious mind, you have a subconscious mind. Some would say we have super conscious minds as well. We have much of our mind that's just not accessible consciously. But your subconscious mind is huge. Some say it's like 80% of your mind is just your subconscious mind. And your subconscious mind can code for you while you're not even coding, while you're doing completely relaxing things. While you're sleeping, you can actually code with your subconscious mind. So Rocket Bunny, when you get stuck on a problem, that's great. You're halfway to solving it. When you're stuck on a problem, you can't figure out how to code, what you need to do is make sure that you've absorbed enough information about the problem that you would be able to solve that. That your subconscious mind will be able to solve that problem without any more information. Okay, so first of all, get enough information. You might be totally feeling overwhelmed at that point. You're like, man, I'm frustrated, I'm overwhelmed, or whatever, I can't figure it out. All those kind of feelings mean that you probably do have enough information. So once you've got enough information in your head, then you want to go completely relax. Go take a shower or watch TV or go for a walk or do whatever it is that makes you relax. Go do that relaxing thing. And what will surprise you is that your subconscious mind will actually be working on that. So the thing is, do not think consciously at all about your problem. If you're thinking consciously about your problem, you're using your conscious mind, you're not allowing your subconscious mind to work on the problem, okay? So that's the first mistake programmers make, is that they don't know how to use their subconscious mind, so they're using their conscious brain too much. And when you're using your conscious brain too much, you get frustrated, you get overwhelmed, and you get all those kind of feelings. So the thing is, relax on it. Let the answer come to you. That's when you're letting the answer come to you, you're using your subconscious mind and you're using a powerful, powerful part of your brain that this should be programming 101, I think, you know, is learning how to use your subconscious mind, but it's really simple. So did you get all that? Nice, man. Nice, right on. Did that help? I guess you'll probably have to try it out. Yes, Azarus. I probably did say that a lot, huh? I wasn't noticing because I was talking. Right, words that size, we're checking that. Okay, so we're gonna search for the color type in with string. If we find it and it fits within our colors, we need to capture this. Get colors, we got C. Oh, this would be return. Return color is it second. Otherwise, return RGB S. There we go. Okay, so now this is going to be C equals parse color words 0. Nice. Yeah, nice, man. Yes, Marza. Nice. Good night, man. Good night, Marza. Words that size greater than 1, C2, parse color, words 1. There. So there, we finally made this data driven. Do I think Unity's good? Yes, absolutely, man. Yeah. You'll be in good hands if you learn Unity and C#. Great engine, for sure. Beetle, yes, of course, man. Of course, dude. Post your links. In 2020, right? What year are you in right now, Marza? That's amazing. Is that your magic? Is your magic doing that? Let's see if this parsed correctly. So should be getting into that method, doing all that. Let's see if that worked. All right, we parsed out these words. We've got, yeah, string is dirt, comma, grass. We should have two words. One is dirt, one's grass. Yes, very good. And these should parse out correctly in here. So step into this method. The second millennium bug. Right. Got that iterator. Now, if it's good and its second value is good, good. Yes. Got colors, return it colors second or whatever. So C should now, instead of being 0, 0, 0, oh, it didn't work. Did not work. Confirmed, did not work. Why is that? Oh, maybe it hasn't said it yet. Oh, yeah, I just hadn't assigned the value yet. Okay. Cool. All right, let's see if C2 gets set right. Yeah, nice. We parsed the colors. That's two more things, data driven. Night, man. Good night, night. See ya. Yeah, okay, this will work good now. Okay, we got colors parsed. Next thing to parse, edges. Are we doing edges or not? That's a really easy one to do. Proceed to generate the texture. No, this is I guess that should be somewhere in here. All right, what are these? Call two, call three. Nice, man, right on. Less than 24 hours, right on, man. Blend colors, right? These blended colors. Oh. Here's something else. We need to blend colors is about this is also based on the colors. Okay, this has to be part of that other code. Damn. Well, okay, let's leave it as it is for a second here. I'm gonna unindent that so that I remember I need to touch up that code. But there, this is really easy. Edges one. If data dot get child. Is it just edge? Oh, edges dot get int. Got a bunch of edges drawn. The thing is, now it's conditional. So if I want to create another type of dungeon or another type of overworld art or whatever, I can easily take set that to zero for if I don't want edges drawn. Next thing, splotches. Yeah, and this there here you go. Here's some hard-coded stuff. It's really nice to get rid of. Checking if the area pauses a certain z or whatever. No, we want this to be data driven where we're checking an actual value based on whatever z or whatever. So we're checking splotches is equal to one now. And this generates some splotchiness on the terrain. And then shading also. Looks like call two and call three are not used until here or there. Oh, really? Oh, cool, Lazarus. Yeah, it doesn't have that. I wish Xcode had something like that. That's pretty neat. You know, another thing I love about Visual Studio lately is their window thing that shows you like a zoomed out version of your whole source file, just like Sublime Text does. It's pretty badass. Yeah, I really got to get the game. I should work more often on Windows, the Windows version of it, because there's a few things I really got to get fixed with the performance on Windows. And it's always good to be getting used to Visual Studio. I mean, the last time I used Visual Studio was 2002 or something crazy. Really? Does that work? Oh, well, that would create a warning. Okay, I guess. Good call, though. That's actually one way to do it, right? Let's try that warning. To do blend colors based on data colors. So this will give me a warning, right? But it's, yeah, there's no specific to-do list yet here in Visual Studio. Yeah, that's actually really great. So there's no real need to put the word to do. I guess, yeah, to do is kind of makes it clear, right? I can quickly look at this and say, oh, that's something I have to do, not necessarily an actual warning. No, what? 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 This is for Fallout? Oh my God, that's such a basic thing. Wow. Yeah. Dude, basics, man. It's not difficult at all to do that. That's crazy. Okay, next on this list, we got splotches, noise 0.02, so. Go float noise factor equal or noise amount, maybe. Noise amount. Yeah, that's data.get child noise get float. Great, we got a noise amount, and then here is where we use it. DRAN times noise amount. Okay, this is gonna be a fun one to test, actually. Is it? Twitchy, Twitcher, Twitch McSteen, Twitch. Twitch is taking a dump. Oh, I messed something up. Definitely messed something up here. This bottom left corner is a different color. Why is that? Figure it out. Okay, but let's modify the noise. Definitely. So here's a good example of making it data-driven, right? I could change the noise if I want to make the noise noisier. There, the noise is now 10% instead of 2. It's gonna be a lot noisier. There, see? You can obviously see how noisy that is. Very noisy. Too noisy almost. Okay, so let's set that back to 2%. And I wonder why it's got that bottom left corner being brighter. Go back to the colors. Or is it quick? Will it be quick to do this shadows? I guess so. Let's do a shadow factor really quick. A range, like a range of noise. I could. Yeah, this is purlin noise used for the grass textures. There's two kinds of purlin noise being used here. J2KO, what's up, man? I'm using something called Valtry. Yes, I created it on my own, but I put it on GitHub. So if you want to use it too, here's a link, man. Valtry. It's very simple file format. It takes a file format like this. It works on indentation to give you depth. And it only has strings, integers, and floats for data. It's very, very simple data format. Very flexible. But here you go. Nice. I wish that was a command. Valtry, it should be. It's kind of like YAML, but YAML has a colon. Valtry doesn't, and Valtry is simpler, a lot smaller. I know, the FooBot's too slow. I am the FooBot. Okay, let's figure out why that color isn't loading right now. So if it's the colors, then it would have something to do with this. Nice, right on, man, Cellular Automata. Dude, that's awesome. Oh, still broken, eh? What happened here? How did that mess up? So like these textures here, or these little dips here, are still fine, but it's got this bottom left is lighter type problem. So it doesn't have to do with the colors. I don't think. Yeah, Ziri, I'm wondering, what is that? When did I get that to be wrong? Yes, Rugged Bunny. True. Yeah, you'll see me do that a lot. I'll sometimes back off on a certain problem and work on another one for a minute, and that allows my subconscious mind to work on the other problem. What happened here? Why do we have this square? Let's do that right now. I'm gonna forget about this problem. I get you. I'm gonna forget about this problem for a minute and focus on something else. So let's do the shadow amount. Blend colors would probably be good too. But shadow amount, is going to be in the general shading. It creates a shadow. Oh, it might be here. F. F is the... Yeah. Oh, here it is. Here's the shadow amount. So that's probably going to create really dark shadows because we were using 0.05 and now it's going to be using 0.4. Yeah, so we've got some really, really dark shadows here. So let's change the data back. So this is actually going to be shadows 0.05. There we go. And yes, that's right. You can say that right now, man. You don't need to wait for a whole year to say that. That's right. You can put that on your wall. True. You got, yeah, that's helped me solve a problem too. So check this out. If we set the shadows all the way to zero, we'll have no shadows at all from the terrain height. Yeah, nice. See that? We still do have a little bit of these indentations left behind, but you really can't see them much because there's no shadow going on. That's fine. Let's put that shadow back how it was. And all right, let's tackle this next thing, blend colors. Probably a little bit, huh? But no, it actually isn't. it generates this texture before it runs the game, so it really doesn't matter what it puts on that texture. The texture is the same size anyway, so really there's no performance boost by using different colors or anything like that. So will it? Yes. Yeah, it'll be not super in depth, but yeah, it does have an options menu already. It's gonna have more options than it does right now. Whoops. So yeah, there's a settings menu. All you can do right now is reset your bindings or add new bindings. But I'll probably have to reword that to be input or something like that. I don't know. But there'll be window size, so you'll be able to choose between having, you know, windowed mode, windowed full screen, or full screen, true full screen. And there's gonna be a few other options like reduce. What's that called? Reduce like the flashy elements, you know, that might give people, you know, seizures and stuff like that. Bad stuff. What are those called? Flashes. Yes, yes, yes. Music and sound. Totally. Those are going to be in there too. Yeah. Yep. Okay, do you think this should be of actual volume control? This is a good question for everybody. What do you prefer in a game? Do you want your game to have actual volume control for sound and music? Or would you rather just have on-off for individually for music and sound? So that's on-off or an actual percentage of volume. Yeah, yeah. That's definitely going to be in there. Yeah, for so many different kind of reasons, right? You might be running a stream on it, or you're doing a recording, you want to put your own. All right, all unanimous. Everybody says percentage, basically. Okay, good to know, cool. I will do that, I will keep it that way. Yeah, cool. Yeah, and it's not necessarily that this sound is good or bad. It might be that some people are like recording something, for they're recording a video, or maybe they're doing a live stream and want to have their own music. So there's lots of reasons why you'd want to change your volume on specifically music or your actual sound effects. Okay, let's get rid of this and do these blend colors. Blend colors, what are these used for exactly? Gotta specify this. Yep, Rocket Bunny, it's true, man. I learned that from starting streaming. I'm like, wow, you know what? Streaming is really cool because I get all this great instant feedback. It's amazing for me. And I hope it's amazing for you too. Hope you guys learn stuff and hope it's really interesting to watch this or inspiring or something. Nice, Siri. Yeah. Yeah. What are these blend colors used for again? Blend colors? Or these are for the edges. Oh. Let's rename those. Should be edge colors. Edge colors, east, west, north, and south. There's like four different kind of edge colors. Aha, and we do each direction anyways. Pierre. Right. Okay, again, I got this now. Edge colors, we should be able to specify what kind of color. There. So edge is dirt. So that basically gives it so we can enable and set the kind of color for the edges to be. So there we go. Edges, currently got, here's what we'll do. We'll test the edge colors. Edge colors dot size is greater than 0. Then we can run this. Nice, right on, man. Right, so we'll go stir equals data dot get child edges. Get stir. If stir dot size greater than 0. Yeah, Rocket Bunny, Azarus is throwing out some good ones here to check out too. That might be the information your subconscious mind needs to check out other engines or something, you know? Here we go. Data-driven edge colors. K-color, dirt. So this is going to be now be it second. Same thing here. This is colors, it second. Oh, that needs to be a color type. Auto type, and here we use type. Here we use type. Bam. Pierre engine. Yeah, I highly agree. Trying them out is going to be something that's really helping you decide this. Okay, let's see if this works. I'm really surprised by how many games are being written with Game Maker these days. You know, Hyperlight Drifter and man, I've seen so many other games like on Kickstarter or Tig Source, that are all lots of Game Maker games, you know? Years ago. What platform? What was it called? It started with an A. There was some engine that started with an A. Yeah, Nuclear Throne? Exactly. Right. That was one. There's a game engine, and it started with, I think it started with an AU. Now it's just giving me up. I don't know, blood. It was on Windows, right? Oh. Oh, it was a game making program. Oh, okay. I don't know if I know what it is then. Oh. That should be a function. Okay, all right, this looks like it's working. We have edge colors, we can be able to do an edge. Nice, great. Arsys. Alright, now we need to find an area that would have edges. Oh, there's one. It's a tiny edge, but you get the point. Same quit there. here. Okay, so let's test that out. Now if we change the edges to be water, let's make them the same color as water. It's gonna look weird, but that will change the edge color. Should work. Yeah, nice. See, it totally worked. We got water. Ooh, that's weird that it has water even for these edges. Yeah, but it works. Okay, cool. Data-driven colors. Yeah, they look like balloons, right? I don't know what they are. I have no idea what they are. I might change them. So if we make the edge colors grass, you shouldn't be able to see anything. Awesome, man. Good. Yeah, try it out. Do some tutorials. You want to do enough with Unity that you're going to give you're basically trying to give your subconscious mind enough information, right? So you got to at least do a tutorial or two, get used to a little bit, you know, get over any kind of initial frustrations you'd probably have with Unity. Any, you know, with any kind of game engine you're just going to try for the first time, you're going to have a little bit of frustrating moments probably. Okay, good. We got edges. Let's put that back to dirt and call that good. We got edges done, splotches, noise, shadows. Everything's looking good except for that one bug with the problem with the bottom left being lighter colored. Okay, I'm gonna do a divide and conquer strategy. So I'm gonna turn off sections of this code until we figure out what bit of the code is causing that problem. So I'm gonna turn off shading in general at first. Well, it might be that actually, where it creates the entity. Yeah, see now the whole thing is just bright green. Yeah, it looks like it was in that section of code right there. Yes, it has. It has. It gave me a nice little solution. It said, why don't you do divide and conquer? I'm like, all right, I'm dividing and conquering. It does, right? All bright like that. So now I'm going to divide and conquer again here, figure out what the problem is. See, it might be the terrain. Call dist. Oh, it could be dist as well. Yeah, okay. Let's comment that line out first. Yeah, that was it. I love my subconscious mind. Right? Isn't that great? I didn't have to bang my head against the wall. Oh, it's very smooth thing. Solve that problem quickly. There we go. Proved it. Bam. Okay, so what's wrong with this whole disk now that's causing that issue to be dark in the bottom left? Probably has something to do with this distance calculation here. Yeah, dist of 1 was 0. Was that what it is? You're farther ahead of me than me in this. First of all, let's get in here with one call to this before it even calls that, because I want to see what size X and size Y. Wait. Now, we should be able to understand this. Size X is, oh yeah, I do want to see size X, size Y first before I make any assumptions. Assumptions bad. Oh, size X, size Y is 420 by 240. That's the size of the actual The texture. Okay, that's the actual texture size. So the texture size, half of it, minus X. I think this started happening when I went from unsigned to signed. Conquest of the New World, huh? Is it on Windows? There we go. Okay, so the problem happened when I went from unsigned to signed. Don't tell me why. Actually, go ahead and tell me why. If anybody knows why that happened, why does this distance calculation come out wrong? Okay, so here's why. This is an unsigned integer. This unsigned integer, when you shift it down, that's fine, right? This still comes out to be an unsigned integer. But when you subtract out X, that unsigned integer becomes a great huge number. And that's why this whole thing breaks down. So really, this needs to be cast to int if I'm going to use unsigned integers here. Otherwise, it's probably just simpler to keep this all this code the way it was. And we're already checking the sizes anyway, so might as well just keep these as ints. Boom, problem solved, and all of this function is data driven. Tim the Incredible Machine? That sounds so familiar, but I don't know if I played it. What did I do wrong? Oh. Right? Yep, okay. Really? Okay, why is this advice? I've never heard this before. Always default to signed. Maybe I have heard of this before, but if you can explain to me in a sentence or two. If not, don't worry. Yeah, thanks, man. Yeah, you put the link earlier. Okay, are we good? Are we good? If you check this part of the code in, huh? I think so. Yeah. Nice. Oh, I know what this is. This is a ramping of the whole. This should be data driven as well. Oh, true. Thank you. Yes. Yeah. Great advice. And now you've helped me understand it too. Thanks, J2. Yeah, I get you there. Overflow is definitely hard to detect. Incredibly hard to detect a lot of the time. You're going to miss that a million times in one. Okay. I get you. And now I really, really understand why. And yeah, and the added benefit of using signed integers is that you can test for values below zero versus values above whatever the hell negative one computes into, you know? Yeah, good point. Very good point. See, I just learned something there. Thank you, guys. That's an important lesson to learn. Alright, yeah, so this last thing, I want to make this distance. This is sort of like a fall off distance type thing. This is a, what should we call that? It's like a, almost like rounding shadow or fall off shadow. Let me show you what I mean. What this is, maybe you guys can help me name this. But this is, if I make this whole thing way bigger, right? If I put this to 0.3, it's gonna really darken the edges, but it's gonna look like a soft pillow. It's a pillow shading. That's what it's called. Pillow shading. Ah, cool. We got a name for it. Pillow. That'll work. So there, you can see the pillow shading now is really dark. And even if I put the light over here, the players over here, you can see it's still pretty dark. So pillow shading. Let's make that data driven. Pillow 0.1. Let's put that to 0.4 so it's really extreme. We can see it at first. And we'll grab that float. Sorry. Sorry. If you have anybody's got a better name, please let me know. But I think pillow shading is the technical word for that, which is always a good thing to use, you know? Keep it that dark. Maybe for some areas. And one more thing, I think that the fill color should be something like fill. Fill should be 0.5 in this case. All right, so we got fill and pillow we can put into this. Yeah, we got that. That might be a good idea to do for those other kind of areas. Some dark, more darkness. We go general shading. So this is where it actually gets this is the fill amount. What the hell is that? That needs to be data driven as well. Then this times pillow. Pillow amount. But make it darker, even darker. Make the dark forest darker. Make it pure black. That's black. Pure black is not dark enough. We need more darkness. So there we go. Okay, so let's try messing around with those two values now. See what kind of madness we can create here. Fill, let's set a fill color much brighter. Like, let's set the fill all the way to 1 or 0.9. And let's do a pillow of super high, like 0.8. There you go. That's what that would look like. We get a really bright color in the center. It's so bright that the color burn shader is giving me this really cool effect actually. And then the sides are really dark, but they're not as dark as I would think they could be. That might be because the distance is never getting to 1.0. Because it's size X. Oh, this is over the size X. That's why. Yeah, so this should be a distance vector. Let's actually fix that. Nice, man. No, it has a limit. It's limited. It's not at all dependent on the CPU, really. The world size is based on it's just a hard-coded thing. I've got it to be 16 by 8. To be reminiscent of The Legend of Zelda, the original Zelda game. What's up, Turticus? Welcome, man. Is this dark? Is this the darkest material ever? UK scientists develop super black material that absorbs 99.96% of surface light. Dude, I love the science we have right now. We have the raddest stuff ever. So cool. Vanta Black. Pure carbon coating. Wow. Wait. It's carbon nanotubes? This must be really strong stuff. When are we gonna have Bucky paper? Seriously, when is Bucky paper coming to us? Bucky paper, where the hell is it? Still, the articles are from like 2008. Have you guys heard? Has anybody heard about Bucky paper and when we're gonna have carbon nanotubes for real? His space camouflage. You look just like space. Is this where I got a vector? No, I'll do this. V. This should be V. Vec 2 V. Is that okay? It's not been defined already? Yeah, okay. Oh, wait, it has. It has. We already got V. Yeah, V is V. All right, so here we go. V dot set. This is going to be V dot length. All right, so now we can multiply the ratios so we can get so we can get a true distance even on the Y. What is Bucky paper? You need to watch it, man. Watch the video, Bucky paper. It's a sweet video about Bucky paper. This is it. Unlocking the power of nanotechnology. Wait, this was uploaded in 2011. Yeah, this is it though. This is a great little video that explains what Bucky paper is. Oh no!